Good morning, Proebstel Church. Let's see, can you hear me through the mic yet?
Nope.
Not yet?
Nope.
It's not working? You said what? Do these work? So can you hear me through? No? All right.
We can hear you.
How about now?
No.
Still nothing. All right. Still working on it. Give us a second here. A little bit? A little bit?
I think it's just my
phone. All right. I'll just talk loud. How about that? Well, hopefully we're coming through okay for the virtual aspect of things. Sorry if there's like a quick spike in volume. Tends to be the case sometimes. All right, well, good morning, everyone. Great to see you today. A little bit of a forewarning. We're going to have kind of a full service because we're doing Lord's Supper and things like that. We've got a pretty full list of announcements here, which I'll start on now. So firstly, just a forewarning, and I don't know many details on this. I tried to look it up online. Anyway, I know that there will be construction beginning soon near the Fourth Plain Bridge near the store. And I believe they're going to put in a roundabout, and I think that construction is probably going to take a couple of months, which means Fourth Plain may be completely closed down. So if you're like me and you live that direction, you're going to have to find another way to come to church. Just wanted to point that out. Also, we have a bulletin board in the hallway out here with 3x5 cards. So the idea is, especially if you're not able to do things around your house yourself and you would like help from others in the church to do it, it's kind of a service message board. If you desire to be served, if you have a need, you can fill out the 3x5 card and pin it to the board. And the idea is that somebody can then take the 3x5 card with them and can take it home and contact you and arrange an opportunity to come to your place and help you out. Also, we have a new book library started. This is kind of you can purchase the books, there's a price on the back, or you can just sign out the book like a book loan program with kind of a 30-day loan window. Anyway, if you have desire for that, they are top picks that Brian and I have put there. So if you want to become a better reader, if you want to learn from some topics, you can go check that out. But especially too, if you want to see what types of books have been really formative for Brian and I, you can check that out. Also wanted to remind you about the Options 360 bottles that are in the foyer. It's an opportunity to grab one, take it home, fill it with change or cash or whatever you'd like, and then we return them all together to Options 360 as a way to do some fundraising for them and to bless their ministry. Meeting. We'll be here to have a barbecue together, and I invite you to that even if you're not in a home group. Also, this Thursday, July 7th, there is not going to be youth group. We are not having youth group Thursday night. Instead, we're going to the lake the next day. So if you're interested in that, or if you're a kid and want to go, you don't have a permission slip yet, or you have questions, you can come talk to me. And also, starting this Friday, July 8th at 2 p.m., Bob and Judy Thompson are going to be hosting a home group and a study through the book of Romans. So if you're interested in that, then you can talk to Bob and Judy, and because they have limited space, but definitely let them know. Okay, this morning's outward update is for Lainey.
It's not working at all.
It's real loud.
We have two updates today. The first one is about the rec singers, and I've been wondering myself, and yesterday they sent out their latest newsletter, and it's entitled Austria or Bust. So we were praying that they would be able to get going, and they are going to. So today, July 3rd, they're on their way to Austria to serve at our team's English camp outreach. And Brett is going to be the speaker, and they're going to have 2 weeks of camp, and then they're going to go to Budapest, Hungary, to attend the European Division Conference. And so their timeline is really exciting. Today, they fly out of Seattle. The 4th, they arrive in Munich. The 5th, they meet with the English camp. And then there's 2 weeks of English camp. And then they are going to go apartment hunting after they get back from Budapest in Innsbruck, which is where they'll be serving. And they hope to return, July 29th, August 6th, they're apartment hunting in Innsbruck. They fly back to Seattle on August 7th. Now they have to come back and gather all their things because they weren't sure they were going to be fully funded. They're very close to being fully funded, and the team has said that they can go ahead and plan to move. So they're coming back, and they'll be back about a month and a half. And then in mid-September, they're officially moving to Innsbruck. So we have a big praise there that God has met their need. They still are, they're at 90%, so they're still at about 10%. So you can still give if you want. And then the second one is about Olga, and she is going to Poland to work with the Ukrainian refugees. Her tickets were paid for with a donation, and the church missions has given her $500, but she still needs more money, and she needs money for train tickets and other travel and lodging expenses. If you want to donate, see Olga and ask what her current needs are. We're happy that we can send her off, and she needs just a little bit more to finish up. So be in prayer for the Rexingers and Olga, and I will pray right now. Father, we give you so much thanks that you have brought the Rexingers to 90%, and they're able to go over and work at this English camp. And we just pray that you would bless their trip. They're hoping that it goes well on the plane, train, and automobile with their two small children. So they're asking us to pray about that they could find an apartment very quickly, and that their move over there would go smoothly. We just pray that you'd bring in this last 10% of support they need. And then we want to pray for Olga, too, as she prepares to leave on, is it the 27th, I think, July 27th? Yeah. And that she would get all she needs to get this trip in order financially. We also pray for her husband that he will be not worried about her going, that he can just release her to the Lord. And when we're in your hands, Lord, we know that's the best place to be. So thank you, Lord, in advance for what you're going to do for both of these families. Amen.
All right. Well, it sounds, we're sounding better here, I believe. Anyway, just wanted to say thank you for your patience with the sound system this morning. We'll be working with pre-recorded music, so worship team, put those mics right up here, okay? All right. I believe you took my notes, Lainey. Can you return them? All right, an eventful morning. Will you please join me as we dedicate this time to the Lord? Well, we thank you, Father, for gathering us together this morning, your people, together to learn from your word, to fellowship with one another, to break bread, and to praise your name. Well, we ask, Lord, that you would use our service this morning and our time to make your name great among us, in our hearts, and in our communities. Well, Father, we all come with different struggles, different hurts, and different circumstances. And though our lives are always changing and always seem to be in different stages of turmoil or hurts and struggles, we know, Lord, that you are constant. You are unchanging, immutable, steadfast in your faithfulness and love to us. So we ask, Lord, that you would remove any blinders, any burdens from our hearts this morning so that we could stand before you ready to worship you in spirit and in truth. And Father, we pray for the gospel ministry of not only our church, but for other gospel preaching churches in our area. We pray for Yackel Community Church this morning. As Pastor Bill is on a sabbatical, I pray that you would provide this time for him for renewal and for rest, and that his church's ministries would be able to continue and thrive in his absence. Also pray similarly for Pastor Nathan from Northwest Gospel, as he is also on sabbatical, that this would be a time for him to rest and to return to his ministry refreshed. Father, we also lift Living Water Church before you this morning. They are continuing to look for one of their preaching pastors to join their team, and I pray, Lord, that you would provide the right candidate for them. And lastly, Lord, we think of Hinson Baptist Church in Portland. We thank you for them and for their ministry. Well, this last week, their office building endured some significant damage and vandalism due to protests. But we ask, Lord, that your hand of protection would be over them, that you would use this unique opportunity for them to bless their community and to show your love, the love of the gospel, the love of Christ to their community, and that they would bring glory to you in that way. Well, we thank you, Lord, once again for this opportunity to come before you this morning. Amen. Okay, please stand with me and hear our Lord call us to worship. Shout for joy in the Lord, O you righteous. Make melody to him. Sing to him a new song. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. For the counsel of the Lord stands forever, the plans of his heart to all generations. Behold, the eye of the Lord is on those who fear him and those who hope in his steadfast love. Our soul waits for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. For our heart is glad in him because we trust in his holy name. Let your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us, even as we hope in you.
Feel kind of naked without Brian up here, but he's getting better.
Silver moon with softer gleam. Thank you, seated. Our scripture reading is from Ephesians 1, 3 through 10. Shall we read together? Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and understanding, he made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ to be put into effect when the times reached their fulfillment, to bring unity to all things in heaven and under Christ. Just a short commentary. You'll get a longer one later. Notice that everything concerning salvation begins, is affected through, and ends with God, through Jesus Christ. By grace are you saved through faith, not of works, lest any man should boast. It says, God and Father, he chose us, his pleasure, his glorious grace, he has freely given to the ones he loves. God's grace he lavished. He made known the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's think again. You may stand.
Praise that exceeds.
Most of you probably have heard that Pastor Brian is suffering from COVID. He's having a little trouble getting over it. And so I volunteered to fill in for him today, for which he was grateful. So I know God will be grateful. I trust you'll be grateful. Let's turn to John chapter 19. John chapter 19. Which somebody just took out of my Bible. Here we go. I'm just going to read portions of it. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. The soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they clothed him in a purple robe and went up to him again, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they struck him in the face. And once more Pilate came out and said to the Jews, "Look, I'm bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no basis for a charge against him." When Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, Pilate said to him, "Here is the man." As soon as the chief priests and their officials saw him, they shouted, "Crucify! Crucify!" When Pilate heard this, verse 13, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judge's seat at a place known as the stone pavement, which in Aramaic is Gabbatha. It was the day of preparation of Passover week, about the sixth hour. "Here is your king," Pilate said to the Jews. But they shouted, "Take him away. Take him away. Crucify him." Verse 19. Pilate had a notice prepared and fastened to the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this sign, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and the sign was written in Aramaic, Latin, and Greek. The chief priests of the Jews protested to Pilate, "Do not write the King of the Jews, but that this man claimed to be the King of the Jews." And Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." Verse 28. Later, knowing that all was now completed, and so that the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. And when he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished. It is finished." There's a line that is drawn through the ages. On that line stands an old rugged cross. On that cross, a battle is raging to gain a man's soul or its loss. On one side march the forces of evil, all the demons, all the devils of hell. On the other, the angels of glory, and they meet on Golgotha's hill. The earth shakes with the force of the conflict, and the sun refuses to shine, for there hangs God's Son in the balance. And then, through the darkness, he cries, "It is finished. It is finished. There'll be no more war. It is finished. The end of the conflict, it is finished. And Jesus is Lord." In the Greek, "it is finished" is one word, tetelestai. Tetelestai. Actually, it's tetelestai, but you add another te to really emphasize it. So it is finished. It means finished, completed, accomplished, fulfilled. When Jesus cried, "It is finished," tetelestai, he was saying, "I have completed every detail of redemption. I have accomplished that for which I came into the world. I have fulfilled salvation's plan." And when Jesus said, "Tetelestai," "It is finished," he spoke the greatest word ever spoken on earth. Tetelestai is the greatest word ever spoken because, number one, it was spoken by the greatest person who ever lived. Jesus was the only person in heaven, on earth, or in all creation who could finish the work of redemption. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made, and without him was nothing made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of man. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right or the authority to become children of God. Jesus came to earth on a singular mission. He didn't come to set a good example. He didn't come to found another great religion. He came for one religion, and that was to do the will of the Father. I have come down from heaven not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all that he has given me, but raise them up on the last day. For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life. And I'll raise him up at the last day. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified freely by God's grace through the redemption that comes by Christ Jesus. God presented him as a sacrifice of atonement through faith in his blood. The word redemption speaks of the work of Christ on the cross when he shed his blood as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Atonement or propitiation, which is a 50-cent word, speaks of Christ being the one who would turn aside or lift away or take away God's wrath over sin. God made him who knew no sin to be a sin offering, a propitiation for us. Only the Son of God, born of a virgin who lived a sinless life, could be the perfect, sinless sacrifice for our sins. Jesus paid our sin debt in full. Nobody else could do it. No other person, no other man could even die for himself. Only Jesus could completely satisfy the demands of God against sinful man. And when Jesus hung on that cross at the end of his ministry, he said, "Tetelestai, it is finished." So it's the greatest word spoken because it was spoken by the greatest person ever lived. Tetelestai also made known the greatest announcement ever proclaimed. If I were to ask you, what is the greatest pronouncement in the Bible as far as our salvation is concerned, you might say the Christmas story, the virgin birth, the Christmas story. And as glorious as that announcement was, his birth and his life alone could not redeem us from a life of sin. Had Jesus not been lifted up on the cross, there would be no redemption. Jesus said to Nicodemus, "Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him might have eternal life." The cross was a divine imperative. "Father, if there's any other way," Jesus prayed, "remove this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." It was the cross or nothing. No cross, no salvation. God could not declare the guilty person not guilty unless a sinless substitute was given. And Jesus was the only one who can make that substitution. And as you look through your Bible, you'll realize, if you read it enough times, that the shedding of blood runs all the way from Genesis through Revelation. All the blood of the animals from Eden to Calvary pointed to the Lamb of God without spot or blemish. All forgiveness since Calvary is based on the finished work of the sinless Son of God who shed his blood for us. Had he not done that, we would die in our sins. When Jesus cried, "Tetelestai, it's finished," he was announcing complete cleansing, complete forgiveness for everyone who would believe in him. And then Tetelestai announced the greatest victory ever won. And that victory that was won had to do with Satan. You read through the scriptures and you soon realize in the background behind all this is Satan. God created the world for man, and he created the world for his son to reign over. Satan, to give you the short version, said, "I'm not going to have it that way." Oh, no, he's not going to do that. Matter of fact, I'm going to be as high as God. Matter of fact, I'm going to be higher than God by the time I'm done. God created Adam and Eve. He gave them one prohibition. You shall not eat of that tree. If you do, you will die. They didn't know what die meant. They'd never experienced die. Die meant two things. Die meant they would die physically, but first they would die spiritually. And the minute they ate of that fruit, they realized something was wrong. God was gone. But they only ate of that fruit because Satan came along and said, "Oh, you can eat of that fruit. You know, there's nothing, you must have misunderstood God. You must have misquoted him." Well, they didn't have a lot of scripture, you know. Don't eat of that tree. We could all memorize that. But they ate of it. He said, "You know, what God really meant was that if you eat of that tree, you'll be like he is. And you won't need him." And so Satan started his battle. Satan wasn't made that way. Lucifer, the son of the morning, wasn't created that way. He was created to be God's servant, like all the other angels. But he decided that, "Nope, I'm not going to be served. I'm not going to serve, I'm going to be served." And millions of people have served him every day since. They've listened to his lie and chosen to follow him. Jesus said that Lucifer was cast out of heaven. He said, "I saw Satan," Lucifer, "falling like lightning from heaven." And from that moment on, he fought a losing battle against the position of supremacy that he hoped to hold over Christ and over God. And in doing so, he's done everything he can to frustrate the purposes and the program of God. Think back with me quickly. We have, you know, Lucifer, as I've already said, witnessed the creation, the miracle creation of man. And he wasn't long in trying to seek to destroy that creation. And we read that sin entered the world through one man, Adam, and death through sin. And in this way, death came to all men because all sinned. All sinned. We don't have to wait to commit a sin before God says, "You have sinned." We sinned in Adam. It's done. We all sinned. And because we all sinned, we sin. Okay? That's how it works. And then God said to Satan, I will put enmity between you and the woman and between your offspring and her offspring, the seed. And that is a prophetic, that's the proto-evangelium, if you want to write that down, it'll be on your test. That is the first mention of the gospel, and it speaks of the coming one, the Son of God, the Lord Jesus Christ, who would crush Satan in the end. Well, Adam and Eve had two sons, Cain and Abel. And apparently, Satan suspected that Abel was the seed through which redemption would come. And by working through Cain, he succeeded in murdering Abel. And I'm sure he thought he'd won the war. Won the war in the first battle. Yay. Time and time again, Satan attempted to corrupt or destroy the promised seed. Think about it. Just a list, short list. Noah got drunk. Abraham lied about Sarah and his wife. The brothers of Joseph sold him into slavery in an attempt to destroy him. And Satan thought he had won the war. But God remembered Joseph, just as he remembered Noah and Abraham, and Satan's plan was frustrated once again. Satan was behind King Herod in the New Testament. King Herod tried to destroy Jesus as a baby. But Herod had not reckoned with the eternal purposes of God, had he? And he failed. But again, Satan thought he could win the war that time, but he was wrong again. Next, what does Satan do? I think he takes a deep breath for about 30 years. And then he tried in a direct attack on the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God himself. After Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist, the Holy Spirit led him into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. The devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, I will give you all their authority and splendor, for it has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want to. So if you worship me, it'll be all yours. And Jesus answered, it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. The devil led him to Jerusalem and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here. For it's written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against the stone. And Jesus answered, it says, the word says, do not put the Lord God to the test. Satan, much like Wile E. Coyote, was having a difficult time with his battle. But he didn't give up yet. And Luke adds to his narrative, when the devil had finished all this tempting, he left Jesus until a more opportune time. I'll just wait it out. I'll just wait it out. I'll work through men, and I'll get him yet, and I'll keep him from going to that cross. He's not going to crush my head. His plan failed again. Time and time again, people picked up stones to stone Jesus, and they couldn't do it. He just disappeared. Why did those attempts fail, though? Because Jesus had not come into the world to be stoned. He came to be lifted up on a cross. That everyone who believes in him might have eternal life. One important statement that John makes in describing certain events is, this happened that the scripture might be fulfilled. You read through the Gospel of John. This happened that the scripture might be fulfilled. None of these things happened by accident. It's what the Apostle Paul meant, I think, when he wrote, "For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins." How? According to the scriptures. All the forces of hell could not prevail against the divine plan and purpose of God. Jesus went to Calvary, and there he paid the supreme penalty for sin, according to the plan decreed by God before the foundation of the world. Let me give you one final way tetelestai was used in the time of Paul, the time of John, time of Jesus. It was used when you had a bill that was outstanding and you finally paid that bill off. They would stamp it, that bill, and it would say tetelestai, which meant it's paid in full. It's paid in full. It would be unmistakable that Jesus Christ came to pay the penalty and all the associated doings with our sin. Tetelestai, it's finished. It's truly finished. Everything John has been preparing us for, if you read through this Gospel of John, is this, that you may believe that Jesus is the Son of God, and that believing you might have life through his name. Jesus Christ, the eternal Son of God, came to do the Father's will. And now that work is finished. Amen. He came to declare his Father's word, and he proclaimed it. He came to glorify the cross. The Father, and on the cross he glorified the Father. He said to the Father, "Father, I have glorified you. Now glorify me with a relationship that we had before you sent me." Thompson Version. It's paid in full. Jesus paid it all. Well, if Jesus paid it all, you don't have to. And you know, God is not trying to sell you salvation. He's not offering salvation at half price. He is not offering salvation on an installment plan. God is offering your salvation free of charge. Jesus left no unfinished business behind. He finished what he came to do, and in finishing his work, he paid the full price for our sins. All that is needed for salvation has been done. It's only for us to believe and receive. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but that we might be saved through him. Amen. We're going to prepare for the communion service. Is there supposed to be another song in here?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Come sing. Reading from Isaiah. The Lord God has given me the tongue of the learned, that I should know how to speak a word in season to him who is weary. He awakens me morning by morning. He awakens my ear to hear as the learned. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious, nor did I turn away. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who plucked out the beard. I did not hide my face from shame and spitting. Behold my servant, his visage was marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. He shall grow up before the Lord as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground, he has no form or comeliness. And when we see him, there's no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors. And he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. And from John 6, for I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have everlasting life. And I will raise him up at the last day. And from 1 Corinthians, for I received from the Lord that which I also delivered unto you, you believers, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, also, he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Father God, we thank you for your eternal purpose in Christ. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Nothing we could do could save us from your eternal wrath. And then we have those wonderful words, but God. But God, you gave your Son to be the propitiation for our sins, that you might be just and the justifier of those who believe in you. Help us to remember these things as we partake of the elements today. In your Son's name we pray, amen. I'm going to have you stand. I don't know what's going to happen, if we're going to hear music. I'm going to have you stand. And as is our custom, go file around here and take the elements and return to your places, and then we'll take the elements together. Go ahead. Jesus said, after he'd broken the bread and given thanks, he said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he took the cup, and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. No more law, no more do this, do that. New covenant in my blood. Believe in me. This do, as oft as ye drink it, in remembrance of me." And the scripture says when they had sung a hymn, they went out. I don't know what song they sang, but we're going to sing, and then we'll be going out.
We will be singing the doxology a cappella.
I'll stand up.
I'll stand up.
Stand up, and I will give the first note. Hopefully it's the right one.
I got it.
You got it?
I got it. Okay. There we go. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Grace and the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. We have a discussion group you're welcome to in a few minutes. You're dismissed.